Right. We're going to have to run real quick again through the context of the argument. Next week, I won't have to do that, because next week we'll be through this long chunk where Paul is making the argument. But I don't want to, you know, to let you get lost in where he is. You recall in chapter 1, 16 and 17, Paul declares that he's not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it's the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, Jew and Gentile. And then in chapter 1, verses 18 through chapter 3, verse 20, this long block that we're in. In that long section, Paul is establishing the guilt of all humanity before God. The dire situation from which the gospel rescues mankind. So that's the burden, really, of this whole section of 118 through 320. And then in the first part of that, 118 through 132, he focuses on the Gentiles. And I like Thomas Schreiner's words. He says, God has stitched into the fabric of the human mind his existence and power so that they are instinctively recognized when one views the created world. I think that's how it works. That God has placed that in there, and that when we see the creation, we know intuitively of God and his power. But despite that intuitive awareness of God, Paul says that the Gentiles suppress that truth and they turn to the worship of false gods of their own making, and then God handed them over. He says repeatedly, it's a judicial act. God handed them over to their sinful desires, meaning he opened the door to their rush into wickedness, to their headlong plunge into wickedness. He just said, go ahead, have at it. You see, and they reaped the ill effects of their sin as punishment. They lived in the difficulties and the problems and all that sin brings with it. They lived in the cesspool that they brought on themselves, that they wanted. And then in chapter 2, he turns his attention to the Jews. And as Grant Osborne points out, he says, greater space and effort go into showing Jewish guilt, for they had too little awareness of their actual position before God. They were the covenant people, and therefore they believed exempt in some fashion from his wrath. Paul shows that that is not the case, and that's how I understand what Paul is doing. 118 down to 320, he's making the case that all humanity is guilty before God. Chapter 2, he's focusing on the Jews, and he spends more time on them because their situation is more complicated. In chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, he says that merely possessing the truth doesn't exempt one from judgment. Rather, when one condemns another for violating God's standard, when one, as the Jews did the Gentiles, when one employs God's standard to condemn another person, one is saying and acknowledging the justice of one's own condemnation when one violates that standard. And that was the position the Jews were in. And then in chapter 2, verses 6 through 11, he makes the point that God is not going to judge mankind by a double standard, one for the Gentiles and another one for the Jews. As sin will condemn the Gentile, which all of them recognize, the Jews certainly would recognize that, as sin would condemn the Gentile, it also will condemn the Jew, so both are in need of the saving work of God in Jesus Christ. That's where he's going and what he wants everybody to see. He's going to make that clear, and then after he lays that groundwork, then we're going to get to, maybe today, I hope, we'll get to where he launches this good news, and he says, but now. You see, but now. In chapter 2, verse 12 to 16, he says that in terms of salvation, it's not merely hearing or possessing the law that matters, but it's obeying it. You see, if one fails to obey God's moral standard, one is in need of rescue, whether Jew or Gentile. And so he makes that point there. In chapter 2, verse 17 to 24, he says that if mere possession of the law, if that will work to secure one's salvation, well, then even the most blatant exercises of hypocrisy, the most blatant occurrences of hypocrisy, well, if possession of the law is all that matters rather than obedience to it, well, then even blatant hypocrisy, doing what you condemn in other people, that would be exempt from judgment. And nobody would accept that. See, that's a powerful emotional argument. Nobody says, look, if I'm telling you, I'm condemning you and condemning you, and I'm going off doing the very same thing I'm condemning, everybody would say, no, no. See, so Paul says, but if mere possession of the standard is all that matters, well, then that would be okay. And everybody says, okay, well, I know that's not okay, so then mere possession of the standard, that doesn't work, okay? 2:25-29, he explains it merely being circumcised will not exempt from judgment one who breaks the law. The issue is obedience to God. All right, chapter 3, we're getting close to where we ended. Chapter 3, verses 1 to 4, Paul says that this doesn't mean that there's no advantage to being a Jew. And he's thinking about some Jews hearing this, and he has a hypothetical Jew in mind saying, well, wait a minute, are you saying then there's no advantage to being a Jew? And he says, no, it doesn't mean there's no advantage. And the one advantage he highlights is that they have been entrusted, Jews have been entrusted with the Scriptures, with the very words of God. And then he anticipates an objection that may be raised. He anticipates an objection that having the Scriptures, wait a minute, that's of no real advantage if Jewish unfaithfulness to those Scriptures keeps them from salvation. So then Paul then says, in essence, look, that the judgment of the unfaithful, that does not in any way diminish the value of the word with which Israel was entrusted, because the judgment of faithlessness is in accordance with that word, not contrary to that word. It does nothing to diminish the value of that holy word that was entrusted to the people of Israel. He ends that section, God remains true to that word even if every human being should prove unreliable. That's this thing, let God be true. You see, even if every person proves unreliable, he remains faithful. Now, there's an implication from this. You see, the implication is that God is glorified, that God is shown to be righteous even when he condemns, because condemnation is in accordance with his word. So it's an act of his righteousness, his justice. He said this is how it is, and when he condemns, it's in keeping with that word. So there's this implication that God is glorified in condemning, because that condemnation is in keeping with his word. And that leads to where we left off, chapter 3, verses 5 to 8. I want to pick back up here. But if our unrighteousness demonstrates God's righteousness, what shall we say? That God is unrighteous for inflicting wrath? And then Paul adds, hey, I'm talking as a human now. You see, from a limited human perspective, when he says, when he mentions God's, he says, if our unrighteousness, that God is unrighteous? Well, Paul doesn't like saying that. You see? But then he says, absolutely not. For in that case, how will God judge the world? Then in verse 7, he reiterates this complaint. But if by my lie, the truth of God abounded to his glory, why am I still judged as a sinner? Paul says, why not also say, as we're being blasphemed, and as some claim we say, let us do evil so that good may come. Their judgment is deserved. Okay, Paul says, look, having said that God's righteousness, here meaning this faithfulness to himself, faithfulness to his word, his integrity, having said that his righteousness is shown even in his judgment of unrighteousness, Paul then raises this objection that this would somehow make it unjust, you see, or unrighteous for God to judge sin. And the idea he's anticipating is that, look, because sin is ultimately good, in that it provides a platform for the exhibition of God's faithfulness and thus for his glorification, well then how, isn't it wrong then for him to condemn what's ultimately good? And so Paul raises this thing, and just the mention of the idea, as I say, of God being unrighteousness causes him to say, look, I'm speaking just in merely human terms. From a purely human perspective, when I say that. But he summarily rejects the idea as absurd. He doesn't have to spend time on it. He summarily rejects it as absurd. If it were unjust for God to inflict wrath, if that, in other words, this argument that's being raised, if that were the case, then God could not judge the world, because God is perfectly just. And since he is in fact going to judge the world, which was not up for debate, that wasn't a matter that was going to be somebody saying, no, he's not going to judge the world. That was accepted and understood. So Paul says, listen, if what you're saying is true, then God would not be able to judge the world because he's perfectly just. And it would be, if it's unjust to inflict wrath, then he could not judge the world. But the fact is, as you know, he's going to judge the world. Therefore, your argument's crazy. Those are my words. But that's how he just summarily dismisses it. He says otherwise, because he just looks here and he says, for in that case, how will God judge the world? Yes. Go ahead. And then in verse 7, he reiterates this thing. He just puts it in different words, you see. Verse 5, but if our unrighteousness demonstrates God's righteousness, what shall we say? Then 7, he just reiterates it, puts it in different words, says, but if by my lie the truth of God abounded his glory, why am I still judged as a sinner? You see, why isn't that not right? If ultimately what's happening is God is glorified and being able to condemn me and that kind of thing, why am I judged as a sinner? And Paul just says, look, if you're going to say that kind of thing, why don't you just go ahead and say, as some slanderously say about us, that we should sin so that good might come out of it. He says, who would think that? That we should sin, that you should advocate and promote sin so that good may come out of it. And he simply says about them, their judgment is deserved. See, anybody, their judgment is deserved. He's saying, look, those people who make these kinds of claims, who advocate for committing sin, and really they're only doing it as an argument, but he says those who would do that, their judgment is deserved. So, okay, so that's where Paul is. And then he says in 9 to 20, okay, we're almost at the end of this section of the setup. Okay, so I won't have to repeat all that we did the last couple of weeks when I tried to keep you in the context of the argument, at least as I understand it. In 3, 9 to 20, he says, what then? Do we have an advantage? We, meaning Jews. Paul is a Jew. And you remember he talked about, you're saying there's no advantage at all. No. He said, you got advantages. He says that in Romans 9. He says there you were entrusted with the words of God. But he says here, what then? Do we have an advantage? He says, not in every respect. Now, you have an advantage. You've got the word of God. You've got some other things. But not in every respect. For we already charged. I want you to see, this is what he's been doing. This is the burden of his argument. For we already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. I've already laid that out. I've already made that case. That's what he's been doing from 1:18 down through the end of chapter 2 and through 3 verse 8. For we already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin, just as it is written. Now he's going to cite a string of scriptures. And he says, just as it is written, there is not a righteous person, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All turned away. Together they became worthless. There is no one who shows kindness. There is not as much as one. Their throats are open graves. They deceived with their tongues. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. All of these are scriptures. Ruin and misery are in their paths, and they did not know the way of peace. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever, that's the end of the scriptures that he's citing or referring to. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those with the law, so that every mouth may be shut and all the world may be accountable to God, because no flesh will be pronounced righteous in his sight from works of the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. Okay, the fact God has related specially to the Jews in history, as Paul has already indicated, they have advantages. They are the people through whom God is working. God gave them and entrusted them with the very words of God. So the fact that God has related specially to the Jews in history, that doesn't mean, he says, we have an advantage, not in every respect. That doesn't mean that they have an advantage over Gentiles in terms of judgment and salvation. They have some advantages, but not in terms of judgment and salvation. Apart from Christ, everybody is judged on their works, not on whether they're a Jew or a Gentile. That's not going to be the test. Well, I got one standard for you, one standard for you. Oh, you're a Jew? Oh, that's fine. No, that's not how it's going to work, you see. And as Paul has already said in chapter 1, verse 18 through chapter 2, verse 29, all people, whether Jews or Gentiles, are under the power of sin. And Paul personifies sin as though it's an entity. This power, this corrupting influence. He says all are under sin and therefore guilty before God. And then to substantiate that point, he says, I've already made that. He says, for we already charged. I've already made the case and laid that out and explained that. And then to substantiate the point, he then cites this string of Old Testament verses stating that human sinfulness is universal. Human sinfulness is universal. Now, certainly some of these texts that Paul cites, certainly some of those texts were, in their original context, they were hyperbolic statements. In other words, statements of exaggeration designed to make a point. You know, my example, that guy hit the ball a mile. Okay? You say, well, that's not, you know, no, well, I'm saying something. I'm making the exaggeration to make a point that, man, the dude hit the ball. You see? So that's what hyperbole is. It doesn't cut out the point. It's just a way of emphasizing the point. Now, some of these texts that Paul cites, they clearly, in their original context, they were hyperbolic statements that were made to highlight the pervasiveness of unrighteousness inside and outside of Israel, but they weren't made to deny that there were any righteous people in Israel. They weren't made for that in the context. There were some who were righteous, but they were the faithful. There were some who were righteous, but they were the faithful, those who were righteous by faith. Paul is saying, listen, these verses are true at a literal level. These verses are true at a literal level in terms of humans as they appear before God apart from His grace. These verses are true at a literal level as humans appear before God apart from His grace. Even Abraham, even David in themselves were unrighteous in the sense of being guilty of sin. You see, they were unrighteous in themselves. So Paul says there is no one who will earn a standing before God. And then he says, whatever the Old Testament law says, law, he uses, law is one of these words that has multiple meanings. And when he speaks of the Old Testament law here, he's speaking about the Scriptures. Whatever the law says, he means whatever the Old Testament says. Whatever Scripture says, it says to those to whom the Old Testament, to whom the law, the Scriptures have been entrusted, meaning it says to Jews. You are the ones to whom God has given the Word. You are the one to whom God has entrusted Scripture. These things are said to you. They're said to you. And then Paul says the reason Scripture addresses the Jews is so that every person, it addresses the Jews so that every person may be silenced, meaning have no defense before God. It's like you go in there and say, all right, what do you got? I got nothing. Silence be in the sense of having no defense before God. And the idea is that if Jews who are God's chosen people, if they have no defense before God, then it follows that Gentiles who have no claim on God's favor, they're also guilty. So he says this came to you and it was said to you so that it could be clear that there's not one voice that can stand before God and have any defense before God. If you don't have a defense, well then it follows nobody's got a defense. So they came to you as Jews, the chosen people of God, so that we could see that every voice would be silenced. Every voice would be silenced, no one would have a defense before God. And the fact of the matter is that no one will be pronounced righteous in God's sight by doing what the law demands. No one's going to be pronounced righteous that way. If one obeyed the law flawlessly, perfectly, completely, persistently, one would then in that case be justified by doing the law. I think that's what he's saying in chapter 2, verse 13. But as I said, there are different ways of understanding that. I think that's what Paul is talking about. But no one does that. Why? Because the power of sin. That's what he said in 3:9 and all these texts. Why? The power of sin. No one does that. Because all Jew and Gentile are what? Under sin. So you have this idea, is that a possible? Yeah, if somebody did that, they would, but nobody does that. Nobody does that. All wind up sinning. Rather than justification through the law, Paul says, comes knowledge of sin. The law provides an understanding of sin's power. It lets you know sin. It provides an understanding and experience of the power of sin. As we fail to obey God's commands and we then incur guilt and condemnation, what is this beast? What is this power? Well, you want to know sin? The law gives us knowledge of that because we see in disobeying what it brings, and you wind up going, what is going on? What is happening? Well, that gives you some insight into what this monster is. What this power is. And finally, we get to this text. See, all of this in my judgment, Paul has been making the case. The situation is really dire and the world is in need. And Paul then says, but now the righteousness of God has been displayed apart from the law. Though being attested by the law and the prophets, that is, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. For there is not a distinction, for all sinned and come short of the glory of God, being pronounced righteous as a gift by His grace through the redemption accomplished in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be, by means of His blood, a wrath-averting sacrifice appropriated through faith. He did this as a demonstration of His righteousness on account of the passing over of the previously committed sins in the forbearance of God, as a demonstration of His righteousness in the present time, so that He might be righteous, even in pronouncing righteous the one having faith in Jesus. Now, Paul has set the stage. He's made this argument. He showed that all Jew and Gentile, all are under sin, under the power of sin, that the law will not save them because this power, they do not obey it flawlessly, perfectly. All are under the wrath of God. And then he says, look, he sets that stage to make this point. And the point here is the availability of God's righteousness to all who respond in faith. This good news that Paul announced in chapter 1, verse 17, he's now developing, he's now elaborating on it. This wonderful, marvelous, tremendous news. He's elaborating on that. Martin Luther, the great Reformation theologian, he called this passage of Romans the chief point and the very center of the epistle and of the whole Bible. So this text has caught some attention, you see. And I can see why he says that, can't you? I mean, this is so rich and pure in what Paul is saying here about God's plan for mankind. Though the law is impotent to save, not because there's something wrong with the law. The law is holy, righteous, and good. And sometimes we slip into trashing the law. It's not because of anything that's wrong with the law. The law is holy, righteous, and good. It is impotent to say because the power of sin has ravaged mankind. That's what happens. And though the law is impotent to save because the power of sin has ravaged mankind, God has now effected or worked salvation apart from law through faith in Jesus Christ. See, this saving activity of God that he talked about, this rescuing activity of God, this righteousness of God in the form of his saving and rescuing people, while outside the confines of the old covenant, this was in fact attested by the law and the prophets, meaning that the Old Testament bears witness to this gospel. You can see pointers. You can see indications that it bears witness to this gospel. So it's apart from the law, but it's also attested by the law and the prophets in that you see the gospel being pointed to and referred to and talked about in different ways. Okay, and this saving work of God, he says, is what is through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. You and I sit here, our lives, the way we are, our twistedness, bentness, all of this, our selfishness, our pride, our ego, all of the things, and we have this gift given to us, this saving work of God through faith to all who believe. And faith is the means by which God's justifying work becomes applicable to individuals. He has redeemed, he has paid the price, and you and I enter into that through faith, through trusting, through believing, through accepting, through surrendering. You see, we partake of that. We appropriate that individually through faith. And this righteousness is available to, and it is needed by all, because there's no distinction between people, especially between Jew and Gentile. That's how he looks at the world. He divides it in two, dichotomizes it, Jew and Gentile. And he says, but there's no distinction between people that has any relevance to salvation. There is no distinction. The question, are you a human? That's it. Here's what Douglas Moose says. Jews may have the law and circumcision. Americans may lay claim to a great religious heritage. Good people may point to their works of charity. But all this makes no essential difference to one's standing before the righteous and holy God. You and I, all on our own, we stand before God guilty. Now that rubs some people the wrong way. They don't even like talking about it. No. We stand before God guilty, condemned, and worthy of condemnation, worthy of punishment. That is the truth. Now, I know we think, no, I'm really a good guy. I'm better than these people I grew up with. They would do that. I wouldn't do that. They would do that. I wouldn't do that. I said this. They wouldn't have said that. I know how we are. I know how we are. But God is saying the truth of the matter is every one of us is guilty before God. Every one of us stands condemned before God. And you see, in the fact of the matter, all have sinned, he says, and fall short of the glory of God, meaning fail to exhibit the God-likeness for which we were created. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We have not lived up to. Now, we are on a path, Christians, where we are increasing in glory, and a path that will end where we will no longer be short, right? In complete sanctification on that day. But right now, Paul says, look, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So any who are pronounced righteous, any who are declared acquitted of all charges, they are pronounced so as a gift given by God's grace through the redemption, through the liberation, through the payment of a price. Through the redemption accomplished in Jesus Christ, a gift. They are declared and pronounced righteous, a gift given what? By God's grace. Given by His grace through the liberation, through payment of a price, through the redemption that was accomplished by Jesus Christ. Our innocence before God, you and I as Christians, we stand completely innocent before God. You know, what was I just saying over here? That look, we all deserve it. In Christ, we stand completely, absolutely innocent before God, and our innocence is absolutely and totally unmerited. We have to understand that. You have to feel that. You have to recognize that. Our innocence before God is totally unmerited. It is something we simply are incapable of buying. You see, we are incapable of earning, incapable of achieving. No one kicks in heaven's door and says, "You're fortunate to have me." Nobody does that. We all come as condemned sinners on whom God in His mercy bestows a right standing because of His goodness and grace and mercy and love. And we simply receive that gift through faith. Ah, you know, is that not great? I mean, look, you know, this is it. This is it. And so Paul is here talking about, he says, God put Jesus forth. He put Him forth by means of His blood, meaning by means of His death, he says, to be a wrath-averting sacrifice. Now, that's how I translate a word, usually translated propitiation, but that doesn't really communicate to people these days. But He put Him forth by means of His blood, by means of His death, to be a wrath-averting, a wrath-avoiding sacrifice, the blessing of which is appropriated through faith. And God's wrath, you see, we talk about God's wrath, and you think, well, I don't know, that makes God seem kind of mean and, you know, flying off the handle. I said weeks ago, that's not what God's wrath is. See, God's wrath, no, His wrath is something that's you know, the necessary and inevitable reaction of an absolutely holy God to sin. It is the necessary and inevitable reaction of absolute atomic white holiness to sin. As I pointed out before, it is not a noble thing to ignore wickedness. Now, we think in our culture that that's really showing that you've got a big heart. No, 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 that's not right. You see, for you to ignore wickedness and yawn at it, that's not a sign of your great spiritual maturity. That is a sign of your hard-heartedness, that evil doesn't bother you. God's not like that. He is not like that. And this is wrath is the reaction of absolute holiness to sin. And God, you see, He initiated this sacrifice of His Son, this outpouring of punishment for sin, this outpouring of His wrath, and He did that so that He might forgive consistently with His holiness. I've talked about this on a number of occasions, but I know you've got to say things many, many times, you know, before so it makes a dent. But I think this is an important concept. See, He does this that He might forgive consistently with His holiness. He's not being persuaded to forgive. The caricature of God is that, well, you know, God the Son, He's like loving. You know, He's really big heart on, but God the Father is this mean. He's over here like this, going, "Rah!" They're God. The persons, one God. He's not being persuaded to forgive as though He's reluctant to do it. Rather, He's providing the way to forgive consistently with His nature, so that He doesn't wink or trivialize sin, that He treats sin as the absolute utter horror that it is. How does He do that? He substitutes Himself for the punishment. He takes the punishment that something that wicked deserves. He doesn't, you know, yawn at it. He doesn't trivialize it. I view the example of the, you know, the fellow that blew up that building in Oklahoma, whose name escapes me now. Remember that guy that killed hundreds of people in that bombing in Oklahoma City? McVeigh, Timothy McVeigh. So you think, okay, well, what if the judge comes up here and we say, okay, yeah, McVeigh, we got you, all right, you're guilty, you're dead to rights and all that. And, okay, give you a week's probation. See you later. And what would be the reaction? And people say, well, you know, wait a minute, that's not right. I was being merciful. Well, you think that would work? People would say, yes, you were being merciful, but you were being merciful at the expense of justice. And so God is absolutely holy and just. He has provided a way that he forgives consistently with his entire being. And so that's what he's doing. That's why all divine forgiveness is rooted in that event. It's rooted in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. There is no forgiveness apart from that. You see, so that's this idea. But he's not reluctant. He's providing the way to forgive. He doesn't have to be strong-armed or persuaded to forgive. He's the one who's doing it. Now, God did this. See, he did this. He put Jesus forth this way. He says, he did this. He put Jesus forth as a wrath-averting sacrifice, as a demonstration of his righteousness. Here meaning as his righteous character or integrity. And that demonstration, you see, it was necessary, Paul says, because God had passed over sins that were committed before the coming of Christ, which he refers to in the time of his forbearance. You see, he had forgiven, he had passed over sins in the time of his forbearance, committed before the coming of Christ. He passed over the sins of the faithful in the sense that he forgave them without the demands of his holy justice, having yet, in history, in a chronological timeline, having yet been satisfied. Okay, so there's an appearance of a justice debt. Here is the absolutely holy God who is forgiving these sins in the time of his forbearance, before the historical event, the coming of Christ. And so there's an appearance. Now God sees all, knows all. There is no justice debt, but there is this appearance in the world of a justice debt because the demands of his holiness have not yet been satisfied. So he says he put him forth as a wrath-averting sacrifice, so to remove that illusion of a justice debt, it was a demonstration to the world in the public crucifixion of Christ. There it is. No justice debt. God has satisfied the demands of his holy justice. And so there was that appearance. He does this in having forgiven the sins of the old covenant. Now he puts Christ forward with his public crucifixion. That appearance vanished. And God's having presented Jesus as a wrath-averting sacrifice, it not only demonstrates his righteous character, his holiness, with regard to his having passed over sins in the time of his forbearance, with regard to his having forgiven sins before the time of Christ's coming. It also shows his righteousness now, you see, with regard to his acquitting sinners in the present. Why? Because Christ provides full satisfaction of the demands of God's holy justice. So he did this to show his righteousness. He is not like the judge who let McVeigh go and say, okay, you take a powder. No, he let people go, but he honored his justice. He did not trivialize sin. He did not treat it as though it was nothing. He treated it with the gravity it deserved, and he took on himself the punishment that my sin deserved and yours. Now that's a God. You see, now that is a God. And I, you know, when people talk about God and they badmouth him, it just drives me crazy. They do not know him. They do not understand him. They do not appreciate him. He is due nothing but praise. Absolutely nothing but praise. Because there is no one like him. And so this is what he says, and Paul is laying this out. Then he says, 3:27, I know the bell's going to so rudely interrupt me, but it does that. All right. 3:27 to 31. Where then is boasting? It was excluded. Through what law? That of works? No, but through the law of faith. For we hold that a man is pronounced righteous by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not also the God of Gentiles? Yes, of Gentiles also. Since there's one God who will pronounce righteous the circumcision from faith and the uncircumcision through the faith. Do we then nullify the law through the faith? Absolutely not. Rather, we uphold the law. Now, we're going to talk about this next week, but this is an important thing. We, in my judgment, have difficulty in understanding. Sometimes we think the idea of moral requirements is somehow anathema to God. He's grown out of that. The idea that he has expectations and demands. I say to people, how can you think that when you read the New Testament and you see over and over and over commands and expectations? You're going to have to do something else to integrate these things because that makes no sense. Well, it does make sense. And so Paul says, rather, we uphold the law. We don't blow it off. But you see, you have to understand something about the law. You have to understand something about the covenant and the pact. And I just don't have time to launch into it now, but I'm going to start here. And when the bell rings, then we'll end and plan to come back next week. All right, so he says here in this first part, given that salvation is a gift, hear that, internalize it, believe it, feel it, so that you never sit here and think, listen, you know, hark, the bell. You know, I worked so hard for Jesus. Oh, man, he's really something. He's just really, you know, I'm quite the guy. You never think that. You understand what you have is a gift. Internalize that. I heard the bell. Thanks for coming.